Good morning.
Good morning.
O still small voice, speak to us this hour, that we might become makers of your peace in our homes, in our church, in our communities, and in our world. We pray all this in the name of the one true God, who calmed the raging sea. Amen. We all stand for call to worship.
Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
The Lord is my strength and my might.
And he has become my salvation.
This is my God, and I will praise him.
My Father's God, and I will exalt him.
If you could all turn to hymn number 593 in the hymnal. Are you going to give us a lead in?
I sure will.
Thanks.
Give me time to turn those pages.
No problem. verses 33 through 37. So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And they told about the things that had happened on the road, and how he was known to them in the breaking bread. Now, as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, "Peace to you." And they were terrified and frightened, and supposed they had seen a spirit.
I'd like to thank Jennifer today for being here. Neil's on vacation, so Neil and Paris normally play it. He's not here today. So we have a special performance by Jennifer Sebibe.
I'm just going to let you know a little bit of what I'm doing here today and who I am. I'm the youth choir director here at Royal Oak First, so the kids all know me, and pretty much so do their parents then. I'm by trade, I suppose, originally a pianist, but then I got into the choral end of things and love that too. The first song I'm going to play for you is one of my particular favorite songs. It's called "Give Me Jesus." And this is a really lovely little arrangement by Mark Patterson. And then I'll have another one. I'll tell you about that when I get to it. This is one of their particular favorite songs, one of mine too. It's called "Part the Waters," and besides the wonderful message in it, I think my favorite thing about it is it's written by a guy named Charles Brown, so I always figure it's Charlie Brown.
Thank you. Morning. Welcome to As We Gather in Service. It's always a blessing to see everyone here. If you'd like to follow me in your Bibles, I'm going to read Matthew 25, verse 21. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." It's impossible to please God without faith. At this moment, I would like to invite our guest speaker. Please come and join us, Minister Bob. He's going to share his testimony, and I'm sure it's going to warm a lot of hearts, fill a lot of spirits, and put some hope where it's needed. Thank you.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Testimony is one of the blessings we receive here at Prud'homme in our As We Gather service. The past 14 months, we've seen testimony from Michelle, from Fred, from Neil. We've seen testimony from Allison. We, in turn, it's my turn now to give testimony after 14 months. I was born a Catholic, a Greek Orthodox Catholic. And the difference with a Greek Orthodox Catholic and a regular Roman Catholic is that when I was born, I made my baptism and my confirmation at the same time. Where if you're a Roman Catholic, you in turn have to go to communion, then confirmation, of course baptism first. So it's a little bit different. So I knew I was different. So being a Catholic, we had to go to catechism. So going to catechism, I got kicked out of catechism 3 times as a child. I guess I didn't like the nuns. And the nuns didn't like me. And they would smack me on the ruler at that time. Today they can't do that. But my time, and Al, I'm sure you remember too, they could smack you on their wrists when you were a bad person or causing trouble within the class. So the father came to my parents' house and said to them, he has to go to catechism. Because if he doesn't go to catechism, he can't get his communion. Now, so my parents came to me and said, you have to go to catechism. And I did and went through it. It was nice. For the 4th time, that was nice and went through the class. Well, that was the start for me of disliking the Catholic religion. And so as my life progressed, I got married in the Catholic Church. I eventually got divorced. In turn, I lost my faith in the Catholic religion. So I went out and searched. I searched all different types of religions. Baptist. I went to a synagogue. I went to Lutherans. But I came here to Prud'homme. And when I came here, I was greeted by a wonderful member. Her name is Diane Wardock. And Diane Wardock greeted me. This was 21 years ago. She greeted me as a stranger, and said, sit with me. Now, being alone and going to all these other churches, this was my last one. And I said, I thought that was the first reason I wanted to become a Methodist, was because of her and her friendliness. And even today, when a stranger comes to our services, there are friendly faces, friendly people who will embrace you and want you to come. So that was my start of being a Methodist. So I went to the classes, I did everything I'm supposed to do, and I became a Methodist. It'll be on June of 1996, so it's approaching the finish of my 20th year and going to the 21st. But I gave up being a Catholic because I didn't like it anymore. But I embraced being a Methodist. What I loved about the Methodist religion first was I could take communion. Being a Catholic, being divorced, you can't take communion anymore. So that was one of the big benefits for me. And it's really a similar religion. But as the years went on, the last 20 years, my career got busy. And I would come, but I would come for the major holidays. Christmas, Easter, you know that. But not until maybe about 3 years ago, I started to come all the time and got more involved with the church. I was always involved, but I got really involved. How many of you believe in the supernatural? Raise your hand. And how many of you believe in angels? And, of course, the devil. One of the things I always carry with me are two things. I carry this rock because I place all my burdens on this rock. And one of our staff here, Heather Noah, who teaches education, is our Saturday night minister. She did a wonderful service here, or as we gather, last year, about picking up a rock, placing your burdens on this rock, and then at the end of the service, being able to put that rock into the basket to give God your burdens. Now, I always give God my burdens, but I'm still not done with my rock. So I have to hold on for a little bit longer because I still have a lot of burdens that I have to put on this rock before I give it to God. I also carry a little box. This little box was given to me by dearest, dearest, dearest friend. And in this box are my wishes, my hopes, and my dreams. So I carry these two with me everywhere I go. Meetings, church, enjoyment. I always have that with me. But I didn't want to give up being a Catholic totally. I'm a Methodist. I gave my vows to God as a Methodist. But you know what I like about the Catholic religion? They have candles. They let you light a candle. You can go to the little flower shrine on Woodward, 12 Mile, big Catholic church, a minor basilica. They have a wonderful area there that you can light candles. And my whole life, while I'm here in Michigan, it's been over 20 years, I light candles. I light candles for my parents, my friends, all the people who were in my life that are no longer with us, my pets. It just brings me a lot of comfort to light a candle. And I do that probably weekly, but I do it at an odd time. I do it midweek, afternoons. I actually leave my office and go and light a candle. Not one candle, but many candles. The funny thing, they have little sections where you light these candles. And I light a whole section when I'm done. They're all lit. But at this quiet time in midweek, I, in turn, go there because it's quiet. So if you've ever been there, you'll know there's a small parking lot in the back of my 12 Mile. And it's like our parking lot. So I pull in one Wednesday, and no cars are there at all. So I park my car, I go in and light my candles. I come out, still no car. No, nothing. Beautiful, beautiful day. And as I'm getting into my car, ready to sit down, I hear a voice. And this voice says, "Excuse me, excuse me." And I turn and look, and there's this woman, and I want to say it, one of the most beautiful women I've ever saw in my whole life, comes walking towards me. Now, being a business person, being from New York, I'm always aware of my surroundings, and I don't see a car. I don't see anything. But this woman, who was African American, who was beautiful, walking toward me. And I said, being the person I am, "Can I help you?" Got out of my car. "Can I help you?" And she said, extending her hand, "I just wanted to meet you." Those were her words. "I just wanted to meet you." And I was taken aback for a second. Because how many in your lives can you recall someone coming up to you and saying, "I just wanted to meet you"? For me, this was the first time. And I've been in my career for 38 years. I just wanted to meet you. Then, within a few seconds, a homeless man, white, comes walking up to us. Where he came from, I don't know. But he was homeless. He had ragged clothes. He was dirty. He was homeless. Typical homeless that you would think. And he came up to both of us and said, "I need to get to Pontiac. Can you spare any bus money?" And of course, I'd do that for anyone, anytime, anywhere. I reached in to give this person a few dollars, and so did this woman, who I didn't know her name, nor did she offer her name. She reached into this little tiny purse. It wasn't a purse. So don't be offended, ladies. It was old. It was something that wasn't from now. And she reached in and she gave this man some money to us. And then this man left. And we, trying to recall it all, we said goodbye. We talked a little bit about this man, what he was trying to do, trying to get to his destination. But there was no, he didn't come from walking down the street. He didn't come from somewhere that we could see him coming towards us. He just was came there, as did this woman. And in turn, here I am, in part, this part of my life, I'm involved in the As We Gather service. This was before that, but I was involved in, heavily in the bag lunch program, the good work we do here in the church. And so we parted ways, and as I got back into my car, sat down, put my seatbelt on, I looked back to think, where's her car? She has to have a car. And there was no car. She was gone. I made it a point to look, to see if this woman, where this woman was. Maybe she was going back into the church. No. The man who we've given a few dollars to, he was gone. Because you would think he would want to woodwork, would have stood there waiting for the bus to go. He was gone. I, to this day, don't know what to make of this. To this day. But I know what happened. I wasn't hallucinating. It happened. And that's why I asked you, do you believe in angels? Do you believe in the supernatural? I do. I've always done that. My whole life I've believed in angels. I pray to angels. But this stuff never happens to me. I mean, I gave my life to Christ as a child. And I reaffirmed that 20 years ago when I became a Methodist. But I didn't have any burning bush moment. I didn't hear the voices come to me at night saying, do this or do that, or pray here or pray there. That's not happened to me. I believe. That's good enough for me. But I believe. However, this happened. It makes you go back and think, what else has happened in your life that you haven't observed when God is talking to you? What haven't you seen? Because we're all too busy. Now, for me, it's moving, it still is. But I have my hopes, my dreams. I have my burdens. I still have them. I'm still human. And I have them. But it's interesting for me that it was this woman, and it was in a ministry that I'm working with here with As We Gather, that a unfortunate individual who needed to go from here to Pontiac happened to come that day. Even to see me in the park. And he wasn't there. But if you know that church, the shrine, there's a little garden there. There's a statue there. I looked even in there to see maybe this man would have been there. He wasn't. They were nowhere to be found. So I know God. I've always known God watches over us. I know God sends us messages for all of you. If you ask, if you pray, God will give you a sign, a solution, an answer. He's given it to me. And I'm not a outgoing, share my life person with anyone in my life, meaning business colleagues, family, or even my closest friends. But here, I have to share this today with you. I think God wants you to know that He's there, that He is watching over you, no matter what place you are in life. But He is there for you. And I pray, I hope, one day I'll understand more why this, to me, angel and angels came to me. I think they want me to continue doing this. They want me to keep helping if I can and minister. So thank you for taking the time to hear me.
Careful how you treat strangers, because maybe you're seeing angels. It sounds as if this lady that you met, when she referred to something to the point of, I just want to meet you,
that's what she said.
Is as if God told her that He has a plan for your life, and He explained it to this angel. His angel just had to come down and, I just had to meet you. God told me so much about what He's going to do for you in your life, not particularly for you, but for what you're going to do for others. And that's a blessing. If anyone would like to speak of how God has touched them and used them in your life, please, you don't have to come up front if you want to, but raise your hand.
Yes, sir.
raise your hand and speak away.
I was just this morning, I called you. I said I was in the rain. I was on my way over. And just got you about 50 bucks. And I think it's absolutely in there. I was going to get some way. Thank you for the service. It's a blessing for everyone. And we're happy to have everyone here today. I think God has given individuals in this world, because you said God has a purpose for each and every one of us. You know, that's part of just what we did. The outer bodies of our soul and our
thank you. Anyone else like to share a moment that God has touched their life? Well, at this time, I would like to ask everyone to stand, and we're going to speak together to God in the Lord's Prayer. In the ways that we speak to our Creator through prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As you open up your hymnal, we are all going to read a revolting Psalm 23. So feel free if you'd like to speak it out loud. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely the goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
In your bulletin, you'll find a yellow insert. One of the nice things that's happened with the As We Gather service is we get prayer, we all sit down. We get prayer requests. And one of the things that has started to happen, and we've listed them here for you, is we're getting prayer requests from people all over the country. People who are in need of prayer. And you'll see that there's a Rhonda Blakeman in Louisiana, and a Tom and Andrea LaForge in Decatur, Michigan. They're seeing what we're doing because they watch our videos of the As We Gather services, and they're finding us that way. So prayer is very important. I've prayed my whole life, and prayer is very, very important. I find great comfort when I pray. I'm talking with Jesus and the Father. During moments of indecision, moments of pain, moments of joy and laughter, our prayers are heard. We pray for family, we pray for friends, we pray for loved ones who are no longer with us. Is there anyone you'd like us to pray for today? Feel free to ask.
I'd like you to pray for my son James. He's 28. He and his girlfriend are on their way to Seattle to live. They have an apartment. He has a job. So I'm really happy and really sad at the same time.
Anyone else would you like us to pray for?
Pat Robinson, a friend of mine, is doing a knee surgery for the next couple weeks. Very well.
Anyone else would you like us to pray for?
Brother Nice and his family.
We will pray for me to get a home, so a real house or apartment or something.
Your first name?
R-E-N-N-E.
Picture of family today, a pastor, Blue. We're not going to be in the board this past week, so we can talk to that.
Pastor, what's his name?
Pastor Richard Blue, who's 72, and he's dying. He was going to extend a prayer, God knows, and never be ashamed of Christ. And he did every day, he wanted to serve God. This one's great for his entire family and church.
We can all bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves to follow your word in every situation that we face. We trust that you are the answers to our prayers. Please watch over and protect James Semivan and his friend, who is moving to Seattle to take a job. We pray that you watch over them. You protect them. You encourage them. And also to come back to visit their family as often as they can. Also, please pray for Pat Roberts, who's undergoing knee surgery and needs your protection and your healing powers. We pray for Renee, who needs a home, a place to live. We pray for Pastor Richard Blue, who passed away, to join you in his glory in the kingdom of heaven. We also pray for Reverend Heinz and his family, who are moving soon to take on new responsibilities in the Flint area of Michigan. These are big, big responsibilities, especially for the people in the churches in the Flint area. We also ask prayers for our prayer list that we have received from Rhonda Blakeman, who needs healing and financial aid, David Pearson, who needs freedom from Satan, from drugs, to stay away from his mom's home so she keeps her sanity. Also for Joanne Blakeman in Texas, who needs help with her health, but is also experiencing marital problems. Tom and Andrea LaForge, Tom's recent hospitalization and health crisis. We pray for their family. For Chuck and Kathy Keeler here in Royal Oak, Chuck is experiencing cancer and he's fighting it. And we know with God's help, they'll be there. For Sandy Spencer, who's also dealing with the coping with the loss of her mother, and also her friend Caroline, who's also been recently hospitalized. We ask for our continued health for Peggy Gill, Mary Nahat, and Dick Bryan. We ask for healing. We ask for their good health. We pray for all here today, and the ones who have not yet discovered the As We Gather service. We pray for all the volunteers who help maintain our sack lunch and monthly clothing programs. I believe that you know everything that I need, Lord. I rely upon you, thanking you in advance for your presence in every circumstance that comes my way. Make us worthy, Lord, to serve those people throughout our community who live, suffer, and die in poverty and hunger. Give them through our hands this day their daily bread. And by our understanding, love, give them hope, give them peace, and give them joy. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Also in the yellow slip, on the back of the yellow slip, is a newer version of Amazing Grace. So Jennifer and Sam, who works in our office, play this at our 7 a.m. worship service this past Easter. And Jennifer would like to perform it again, and for all of us to sing. It's a little bit different version of Amazing Grace, but I think we're going to like it.
You'll find it's very much similar to our original version. There's just a little place in the middle that they throw something new in. So if you don't know the new part in the middle, listen once, and I bet by the second time through you'll have it.
Thank you.
construction, this chapel will soon be gone when they get this part of the building. But we'll have a new chapel upstairs. So we praise that. But in the back of the room, there are some Bibles, daily devotionals, so please feel free to take one if you'd like. But also in your bulletin, you'll find Bible study. Starting tomorrow, 9:30 to 10:30, prior to getting your lunch at SAC lunch, we're doing Bible study downstairs in Fellowship Hall. It's going to be every Friday. We're starting with the book of Matthew. It's going to be a movie, Bible reading, and discussion. We're not trying to teach. We're just trying to learn. We're just trying to see. Good time to fellowship. Good time to be here. If you're here for SAC lunch anyway, at 10:30 to pick up a lunch, come at 9:30 on Fridays. Do Bible class. And learn more about the Bible. And the reason this started was because sometime last year, at one of our As We Gather services, a gentleman came up to me and said, I've never read the Bible. I don't own a Bible. We gave him a Bible. Hopefully he's reading the Bible. But he never read a Bible. And if anything, by being in this Bible class and study, it's open to all. Our goal at the end, maybe a year from now, we'll be able to say, I've read the Bible from cover to cover. Now let us stand for the benediction. Grant, O Lord, that what has been said with our lips will may believe in our hearts, and that what we believe in our hearts we may practice in our lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Until we meet again on April 28th at 11 o'clock. And in Bible study tomorrow, hopefully, at 9:30, each and every Friday, go in peace. Amen. Amen.
Good thing I know most of the hymns.